Hello, hey guys, welcome to Concept and Coding, and today we are going to do a very important question, design rate limiter. But before going further, first you tell me in the comment that in which company you have faced this question, right? So with that being said, let's move and let's see how to design a rate limiter. So first let's understand the problem ki ye banaya kyun hai, why we need rate limiter. So everybody I think knows of this, right? DDoS attack, right? So here in the DDoS attack, what happen is attacker sends unwanted request to a server, and each server has a limited resources, RAM and disk space. So everything is limited. So now what happens is attackers send lot of thousands and even lakhs of requests in seconds, that all of this resources are consumed and the server become down. And when the server become down, what happened to the genuine user? So when genuine user do a request, their request will get declined. So that's what is known as DDoS attack. And to prevent this, we bring the rate limiter, and that's what it makes it the most important interview question. That because as a backend software engineer, you have to work on APIs. So you should be aware of how to limit a rate on a APIs. Okay. So let's jump into the rate limiter part. But before that, before we do designing of this rate limiter, right, there are certain algorithms which you should be aware of it, right? Without those, it is very difficult to come up with the design itself. So there are five algorithms which you should know, right? I will try to explain in a very simple and quick manner. So first is token bucket. Second is leaking bucket. Third is fixed window. Fourth is sliding window, and fifth is sliding window counter. And this counter words come from fixed window counter, sliding window log, and sliding window counter. So these are the five algorithms: token bucket, leaking bucket, fixed window counter, sliding window log, and sliding window counter, right? So let's start with first algorithm, token bucket, right? What does token bucket is? So here understand with simple diagram. So bucket, as the name suggests, there is a bucket. So this bucket has certain property like capacity. What is the capacity of this bucket to hold? Capacity of what? To hold token. Let's say I say 4, so it can hold, let's say 4 token maximum, right? If you try to add more token, it will overflow if you try to add more token, okay? And there is also something called refiller. This is known as refiller. So refiller has a property that in 1 minute or 2 minute or 3 minute, how many token it will add, let's say 2 token. So this is all driven by configuration. This is driven by config file. Like we can change it. When I say by config file, means these are dynamic values, you can change it. So token bucket has a bucket which has capacity. What it can hold? Tokens. How much? Let's say for example in this case 4, right? And there is something called refiller. Refiller work is to keep add tokens after a particular time. In this case I am taking that after 1 minute, 2 tokens will be added. If tokens are excesses, means already 4 are there and 1 minute done, so refiller will add 2 tokens, so there is no space in the capacity, so those 2 tokens will get into overflow, means they are removed. So now how this token bucket is used? So if you see that whenever a request are coming, so whenever my particular request are coming, what it will do is it will first check. So there will be first condition, right? And the condition will be on the bucket. right? What it will check, is there a token present, right? If there is a token present, yes, then this request will consume one token. This request will consume one token. Let's say it has 3 token currently at present, for example. So when this request comes in, it consumes one token and the count will reduce to 2. If there is no token, if the let's say token is 0, then if there is a token, has token, no, then it will be, request will be denied, right? So this is generally a small, you can say that flow diagram, how the token bucket works in. So now you got this flow. So now we can configure this token bucket like per user, per API wise. Each user, this is my rule, for each user, 3 counter or 3 token, you can say that 3 token, right? And for per minute, in per minute or in 1 minute, right? For post API, tweet post API, let's say. So this is one rule. This is one rule. So rule can be, right, for each user, for each user, right, how many token available? 3 per minute to tweet post. So how we can do is, like, for each user it can be store some counter. What is the counter or token? Let's say currently it is present 3, and when a request come, post tweet, post tweet, so it will see that counter is present 3, yes, for each user. So counter is 3, so it will reduce the counter to 2, and it will put some timestamp, let's say time when the request comes, let's say 10:01, right? So now let's say there is another post tweet request come, right? So what does rule says that in 1 minute 3 tokens are present. So again user 1, so I am maintaining each user wise, right? So counter is still 2, so counter will get reduced, counter will become 1, and let's say time is still inside 1 minute, right? So let's say 10:01 something 25. Let's say another post request come, post tweet, same user, counter will become 0, right? And the time it came is again within a time limit, let's say 35 seconds, not 1 minute is completed. Let's say another post tweet come, again user 1, now counter is 0. Now if you say counter is 0, now there is, till now refiller has not yet run, right? Refiller, let's say I am here saying that refiller is, refiller fill in 1 minute, it will fill 2 token, let's say, for example, right? So till now 1 minute completed, no, 1 minute is not yet completed. So this request will get, counter is 0, this request will not be entertained, this is removed, denied. Now let's say one request, another coming is post at 10:03, for example. So now in 10:03, what would be the counter refiller had added? So 10:01 means 10:01 to 10:02, 1 minute, 10:01 to 10:02, and 10:02 to 10:03. So it might have refilled the counter, right? So let's say the capacity was 3, capacity was 3 and it was become 0. So here at after 1 minute, it will, refiller have added 2 token. So out of 3, so counter become 2. Then another request, after another minute, refiller have run and it will added 2 token. So 2 token it will try to add, but the capacity is only 3. So it will add 1 and 1 token will get overflow. So this is become my counter. And one request is coming, then it will say that, hey, counter is again 3 and the request will be processed. So counter, it will reduce one counter because of one request. So it will become 2 and it will put timestamp. I hope the, what I wanted to show you, that this token bucket can be easily implemented through counter, right? So this is very easy. And if you see that, right, one more thing I was just wanted to tell you, that whenever any request is declined, HTTP code which is returned is 429, means access request in a time limit, right? I hope you got it, the token bucket, right? Yeah, aage acche se samajh mein. Now let's go to the leaking bucket. Leaking bucket is very simple. Leaking bucket is very simple and very similar to token also. So here in the leaky bucket, what happened is, again, it's a bucket, right? Leaking bucket, as the name clarify. So there is one tab, you can say, that from where requests are coming, right? Irregular flow, sometime more, sometime less. And this bucket has a capacity, fixed capacity, right? So it has a fixed capacity, right? And out of this request which are coming in, so these are requests, out of this request coming in, there is a leak. So leak means at a fixed rate, at a constant rate, at a constant rate, this request are processed. So if the incoming request has more and or in the more rate than what we are processing, then there will be overflow and that request are denied, right? So here the leaking bucket is implemented through queue. It is implemented through queue. So here this, here what happened is, so let's say when the requests are coming, so request will come and then it will do a check, or it will do a check, right? So is queue full? So there is a queue present here which has fixed capacity. So if queue is not filled, no, then request is added here in the FIFO form, first in first out, and from here it will be processed in a constant rate, So this is request one. Similarly, request 2, like this it will be added. If the queue is full, yes, the request will be denied and HTTP, which code will be sent? 429, right? So you got it. So here if you see that the only disadvantage of this algorithm is, this is simple, but disadvantage of this algorithm is that There are certain you can say that application in which the constant burst can come. For example, take an Amazon Prime, right? So maybe during daytime the traffic is not much as compared to evening or night, right? So this is a valid kind of scenarios. In that case, this leaking bucket rate limiting will not work, because so this is the new request and this is the old request is still holding in the queue, because these, here it is going slow. So this is a specific requirement. So ask from the interviewer, like what the application they are developing and do they require a constant rate, right? So depending upon an algorithm. Similarly, if it is kind of an Amazon Prime, this algorithm is not efficient. Okay, so you got it. The leaking bucket algorithm. The third one is fixed window counter. This is again very, very simple. Fixed window counter. Ab iske andar kya hota hai ki ek time frame ko, let's say we have 24-hour time frame, right? It divide into, let's say, particular time limit. Let's say for example 2 or 5 minutes time frame. Let's say 8 o'clock, 8:05. 8:10, right? Similarly, you got it, right? So let's say this is my fixed window. This is my fixed window. Let's say what is that fixed window is 5 minute, right? And counter, what is means? Each window has a counter. Each window has a counter. So fixed window is this and counter is, let's say, 3, means each fixed window will get a 3 counter. Or you can also define this, right? So we have, like, you can change it from 3 to 4, 4 to 5, right? These are config derived. So from 5 minutes you can change it to 2 minutes time frame, right? So I'm just taking this as an example. So now when the requests are coming, request 1, okay, so 3, it will reduce to 2. Another request come within a time, within a particular fixed window, so it will reduce to 1. Another request comes, it will reduce to 0. Now another request try to come. Now here if you say counter is 0, you can't add it more, so this will be denied. You got it? So, and again in the new window, it will again, counter is set, and again it will be processed. But it has one disadvantage, right? So this is a very big disadvantage. Disadvantage is like, let's consider this 8.10, let me make it clear, 8.10, 8.15. So this is counter 3, this also has counter 3, right? So now let's say at this point, before this time frame finished, at this point there are 3 requests come in. So request 1, request 2, request 3, right? So it is still within a time frame, it is possible, right? Counter is 3. And also let's say that within the second time frame, request comes here, request 1, request 2, request 3, it is possible, right? 3 counter, and it's a new time frame. But if you see as a overall from the higher perspective, within a 1 minute or 5 minutes, 5 minutes mein kitne hone chahiye the? In 5 minutes it should be 3, but here if you see in the 5 minutes, how many happened? 6. So in the edge scenarios, when the request comes on the edge, the disadvantage is the number of the tokens, right, or the request can be double, right? So for which our system might not be ready. So this is what the fixed window counter and its disadvantage, right? And this problem is get solved by sliding window log. Sliding window log has solved this problem. Very simple. Sliding window log. So sliding window log is very simple, right? So I think in DSA we have no sliding approach, right? One design sliding window, right? So similarly in this case, so here earlier we were divided into fixed time frame. Acha 5 minute, to matlab 5 minute ka fixed time frame and a counter, right? But now here the sliding window is, first of all it is not counter, it is log, just remember this, but I will come to this. So what sliding window is, now time, the window slides, there is no fixed time frame first. And how we use a log for this sliding is, I'll tell you. So let's say first request comes in, let's say I will take for example 3 requests per minute, right? 3 requests per minute is my allowed configuration, right? So now what will happen, I am using sliding window log. So in the log, what does we log? We log timestamp, right? So now let's see how. So now let's say a request comes per minute, just remember I am doing a per minute. So let's say one request is coming, request 1, let's say it come at 10:10, right? So I'll put a timestamp, so it is logging a timestamp. Now its size has become 1. 10, this is 1, I'll log it. So I log the timestamp, right? So now let's say another request coming, request 2. At what? Let's say within, so currently a window is there, right? So this timestamp, consider timestamp as a sliding window. So 10:10, now window started, let's say. So what is that per minute? 3 requests. So per is minute done? No, from the last one, and it is in a sorted form. So no, let's say this is come at 20, right? So it is within a time frame, yes. So it's my 10:20, it's within a window of 1 minute, right? So 3 requests, so size become 2, it's still a valid. Again request come, third request come, 10 00, let's say 40. Again, this is the window till this is my starting window. Does 1 minute finish? No, 1 minute is not finished, right? So, and the request is 3 and the size is 2, so it is still a valid. So I will log it. 40, size will become 3, right? Now let's say one more request is coming, 10 00 45, so it will log 10 00 45, right? Now it will check, does limit crossed from this is the starting, right? All this in sorted form, right? This is still the starting point. So does 1 minute cross? No, 1 minute is still not crossed, right? But can I entertain this request? No, size is 3 and 3 requests are only allowed, so this will be declined. So this will be declined, but it will log this one, it will log this one, right? Now let's say another request are coming, another request are coming at let's say 10 01, something at 20. This is another request coming at 10 01, right? So now first of all, it is now, if you see that it has crossed the limit, now window is crossed with 01, window is crossed, right? 00, now 01, new window started, right? 1 minute is done. So means window has to slide. How it will slide? From the top sorted, it will remove till it comes into a window. It will remove this. Disadvantage of this is, like I told you, right, even the request is denied, we are storing its log. It takes lot of space because even the request is denied, we are storing it timestamp. I hope you got it, right? So now we have one more thing is last is, then after that we will do a complete design. Sliding window counter is, so here now we have is sliding window counter. So sliding window counter adds two functionality. One is fixed window counter plus sliding window lock. Window counter solves make use of this two approach, and we know that it takes an advantage of the both. So in the fixed window counter, the usage of the counter is very intuitive and very easy to implement, and the sliding window log, the advantage is it solves the disadvantage of the previous one, right? And during the edge, it is possible that double the request can comes in, so sliding window log solves that, right? So sliding window counter is very easy to implement. Let me tell you that how it can be done. So let's say there is a time frame of, let's say 1 minute. Rule is, what is the rule? In 1 minute, not more than 5 requests can come, for example, right? So let's say 8 01 8 02 8 03, and we, let's say it all have a counter, like in fixed window counter, counter is 10, right? So there are requests present here, some requests could be here. So now let's say a particular window, so this is what used to happen in fixed window counter. We have a time frame, we have a counter, right? And now we are using the sliding window also. So now let's say currently the time frame which is running is this, right? This is the time frame currently which is running, right? So here consider this as a previous time frame and consider this as a current time frame, right? So ultimate goal of the sliding window counter is to find the number of request present in this window particular 1 minute window. So we are calculating 1 minute, right? So in this 1 minute, how many requests are present, right? So it is very, very simple. It's a normal math formula, right? So here, if I divide this into this current time frame, so in current time frame, we already know that two requests have already come, two plus, right? Two requests has already come. So now here we just need to find out how much request will here. So it's a very simple formula, right? So you know that, let's say this is 60 interval, 1 minute, 60 interval, and let's say this is present, this sliding window, this part in the previous time frame is span around 10 interval. So it is very easy to find out the number of requests. So let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 requests, or we can say that in 60 interval, 6 requests. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. In 60 interval, 6 requests. Then in 10 interval, how many requests? We know, right? 6 divided by 60 into 10. That's what it is. 6 divided by 60 into 10. So this what generally it try to find out the percentage here. Try to find out the how many requests will come here in this one. How many requests are there out of total, right? Once we know how many requests are there plus the current time frame request, then it will compute that does it less than 5 requests or not, right? Now we have all done the algorithms. Now let's come up with the HLD diagram of this one. So what all components we have seen, right? So you know that in bucket we need counter, right? So this is something we need to update, fetch and delete counter, right? So definitely we cannot use disk because disk are very slow. So definitely we need something kind of in memory. So Redis is the one we have to use to maintain a counter. Let's say, right, in token bucket we use a counter, in leaking we are using a queue, right? So we might need use a Redis. And I also told you that we are using a config file in many places where we store the config. All these are nothing but a config. How many fixed window counter, like in per minute, 3 requests per minute, these are nothing but a config. So we definitely need config also, right? So now let's design the this one HLD. Let's say we have a client, we have a server, right? And we need to put a rate limiter, right? So rate limiter, so these algorithm should be hosted by someone, right? So there are two ways. If we host some rate algorithm, rate limiter here, right? And it will have the appropriate algorithm, or let's say we can have a proper rate limiter here in mid between a client and server. So that depend upon the meeting or discussion with the interviewer, that what he suggests, right, based upon the company requirement. So if let's say if client send a request and there is no gateway in mid, so we can ask that we can host the rate limiter algorithm here, right? And let's say there is already certain concept like API gateway which do authentication and all, so we can put a rate limiter algorithm there so that any request comes in, it goes through our API gateway which is hosting our rate limiter, and then it goes to the server, right? So I am assuming that we are going with this. So how we will do there is, let's say we have a client, then client send a request to our rate limiter or API gateway, you can say that rate limiter, right? And rate limiter will send a request to our server. This is we know basics. Now I told you that we need a Redis to maintain a counter, queue and all these things. So definitely rate limiter also should have Redis, which will maintain, like, okay, this is the counter updation and all. It has supported various features like fetch, update of counter, queue, and various things. Similarly, there will be some config files, right? Config files. So generally, config files are stored somewhere on disk, but we cannot read config files directly from the disk. So we have to maintain some cache in mid, right? Because config files are changed very less frequently, so it's okay. Whenever our application start, we will load the config file into cache, and our rate limiter read that config file from the cache, right? So based upon that algorithm, it will either send 429 or send okay or success, right? So this is generally the very high level design of rate limiter, but most important are algorithms in this run, right? So you got it right. What are things which we can do? So here Redis is like, it is so let's say one more follow-up question can come is, let's say this is distributed, there could be multiple rate limiter. So this is rate limiter 1, rate limiter 2, rate limiter 3. There could be distributed rate limiter, right? And client might have come here, client can come go there, client can go there. So to answer this is always say that Redis, we will use Redis, because Redis is what is like centralized data store. It is centralized data store. So everyone has access to this one. Now the follow-up question can come is like, Redis does not maintain atomicity. Why we need it? Let's say token bucket, we are maintaining counter. So let's say this is also read the count. So let's say the client send a parallel request to rate limiter 1, rate limiter 2, and both read the counter. Let's say currently here is 2, both read counter 2, both read counter 2, right? So that could cause an issue, right? So then client interviewer say that if you use a Redis, which is a centralized data store, how you will maintain a atomicity? So one of the answer could be like, there are certain already solution present to bring. So we can add atomicity. We can bring atomicity to the Redis, but the overhead would be little bit latency, right? But there are already solutions present which we can use it and bring the atomicity to this one. We don't have to develop from our own, right? But the only thing is latency. But if interviewer says that yes, we can use this and we can bear the latency, then definitely we can use this. Otherwise, this is you can say that one of the limitation of having this, and there are some little bit loopholes. I think it is pretty much clear to you, and all this five algorithms and the high level design of it. And guys, please do share it with your connections if you like it, and I really need your feedback where I can improve and all. So waiting for your comments, guys, and wish you luck for your interview. Good luck. Bye.